I'll give you a simple, straightforward answer. I don't have any agenda, and moreover, this is not the crowd where I need to convince or prove anything. You are already sadhakas, either for the sake of physical healing or for mental healing or for spiritual healing. You are here. All of you already have an introduction and idea about the yoga tradition or Vedic tradition. So I don't have to convince you. Only if the need for convincing exists, you need to go on using big words and clothe the truth with a big coat and suit and everything. Here I won't clothe the truth with any. I'll just straight away give you the naked truth as it is. Maybe you have any question, anybody, you are welcome. Yes.
Swamiji, being your student of a university, I am taking this privilege to ask you one question.
Yes.
Being at young age, you have gone through various deep sadhana. But can you explain a little bit your experience?
All right.
Thank you.
I had the fortune of sitting at the feet of Ramana Maharshi's disciples. You must have heard of Ramana Maharshi, a great master who lived in Arunachala. There's a place called Thiruvannamalai, 5 or 6 hours drive from here. That's my native place. I'm born and brought up in that Arunachala. Usually in India, Swamis don't tell their native place or don't feel proud about it. But in my case, it is not geographical connection. I have a deep spiritual connection with Arunachala. So, I'm proud of that place. And I always feel connected and I have a deep respect for that place. It's one of the very powerful spiritual energy center and world's biggest Shiva temple. Something like a 27-acre built-up area in granite and a huge tower, 220 feet or something. World's biggest Shiva temple is there. World's biggest Vishnu temple is in Srirangam. Biggest Shiva temple is there. I had the fortune of sitting at the feet of the Ramana Maharshi's disciples, one Annamalai Swami. Maybe some of you would have seen him also. A great soul who left the body only 95, 10, 12 years ago. He was, I can say that around the age of 10, I started visiting him. It's like a not any spiritual reason or anything, just my parents will take me. In India, you know, the parents will force the kids to go with them when they go to these temples or to meet Swamis. One nice thing with that Swami is he will always give candy. So, he'll give some sweets. So, I'll never miss when I know that they are going to meet this Swami. I'll go there and sit with him. Many times he will give candy, and maybe because of candy, I felt very connected to him. Not anything else, just you don't need to do anything and you can just sit and you don't understand also what he talks. It's good in a way, you are not disturbed, you can mind your business and at the end you have candy. So, one day, somehow, I don't know whether fortunately or unfortunately, I was drawn to what he was talking. He was talking something like, we are not body, we don't have suffering, we are beyond pain. These kind of words. Not only I was not convinced, I was not able to understand. How can he say that we don't have pain? If my mother beats me, I have pain. In Indian villages, you know, the parents will kick the kids if they do something wrong. And I think in the cities the habit is not there now. Cities, no, we don't have. In villages, still in the villages it is there. Still in villages it is there. The parents will beat the kids. I remember that when my mother beats me, I have pain. I have suffering. Anyhow, I went to the home and continuously contemplating on this word. He is saying that I don't have pain and we don't have pain, we are beyond suffering and we are Atma and all those things. I was not able to brush him aside also because I somehow felt he is a very honest person. He is a very truthful person. He is not a person to tell lies. Maybe because of candy, I don't know. That relationship is developed. Because of the relationship, I was not able to just reject him, completely throw him away. I was continuously contemplating. Then took a knife from the kitchen and cut my thigh to see whether I have pain or not. Still the mark is there. Of course, not only I had pain, my mother gave me few puja and took me to the hospital nearby, and they did first aid and whatever they need to do. Something like a 13 stitches they made, such as deep cut. 13 stitches they put on. Anyhow, I became all right in maybe 10 or 15 days. I became all right and I went to him again and asked him, what is this? What have you taught me? You told we don't have pain, we don't have suffering. And still I remember he was repeating some Gita sloka, nayanam chindanti sastrani nayanam tagati pavaka. See, this Arjuna, this guy is intelligent. When he heard all this truth, he killed others and verified, not himself. But in my case, I went and cut myself. That's where the problem started. Anyhow, I went and asked him, what is this? What have you taught? You did like this. And I'm having pain and suffering. My mother was shouting at me. He said a beautiful word, still I remember. His eyes became very compassionate and soft. And he said, my son, don't bother. Just look inside and see from where the pain idea is coming into your being. See, now I am using a very logical words to you. He was not using this many words. In Tamil he said, Tamil is my mother tongue, in that language he said, Vali yaarukkunu paarra. He told me, who is having pain, look inside. Please understand, I tell you honestly, I am a 10-year-old boy. I can't understand the Vedanta philosophy. I can say, honestly, he initiated me with that word. He initiated me into that method of enquiring or going into the truth. Now I know all these big words. It's a self-enquiry, great Vedanta vichara, and all these words. To tell you honestly, at that time, fortunately, I did not have an intellectual stuff. Otherwise, I would have idea, oh, it is a big thing, I cannot do. Fortunately, I did not have all that intellectual background. Because of that, I was very simple, relating very simple way with him. And he told me, who is having pain? Look inside. Anyhow, I told him, all right, I'll look inside. Then, even then, I was not convinced. I was asking him, okay, you could have told me about this meditation dal before I cut myself. Why did you make me cut myself? Then you are teaching all these things. He told very beautifully. That word still I remember. It's a very strong word. My son, don't bother about this pain. Your spirit to experiment with the truth is much more valuable than this pain. Forget about it. Keep that spirit alive. You will never have any pain. It was a very strong word from him. Keep the spirit of experimenting with the truth alive. Keep the spirit of playing with the truth. Maybe I can say the first word, the word which he uttered was initiation. Means like initiating me into the technique, into the truth. The second word which he uttered is giving courage and confidence to travel in that path. To travel in that path, to continue the journey, to do my tapas. That was the first and very strong inspiration. And I was playing with the technique. Whenever I find time, I'll sit and see that from where the pain is coming. Sometimes it will feel like the pain is in that area, same area where I had the pain, where I had the cut. Sometimes suddenly I'll feel the pain is coming from some other area. Somewhere else, I'm remembering the idea of pain. So it was just a play for a few days. The technique or the method. One day evening, I was sitting at the foothills of Arunachala and trying to play same way with this technique. It was not a serious meditation or tapas or anything. It was just a playful remembrance or trying to see from where that idea that I am suffering or I have pain is coming. I was trying to find the source, and by the grace of Arunachala or by the grace of the Annamalai Swami, the Guru Krupa and the Daiva Krupa, some strong experience happened, something opened up inside. I was sitting with closed eyes, but the opening was so strong, I was able to literally see whatever was there around me 360 degree. Of course, it's a very mystical experience. If you are not able to logically accept, please forgive me. Forgive me for intruding into your logic. But what I am saying is honest truth as it happened. Whoever can catch, catch. Complete 360 degree. This side and this side. All the direction I was able to clearly see at a time. Not only I was able to see, it's like that hill which is in front of me, that temple which was on the side, and the trees, plants, rocks which was around, and the sky, and the ground, the whole thing. Not only I was able to see, to tell you more clearly, I was able to just feel everything is my very being, I can say. See, now usually people feel that they are alive inside their skin. How you feel alive inside their skin? That same depth of life I was able to feel in the pillow and the plant and the flower or the mic, whatever is in front, whatever is around. How you feel you are living inside your skin, inside your boundary, the same depth of intense life or feeling I exist, I am alive, happened with the whole surrounding, whatever was there in the 360 degree. It was a very strong experience, very strong feeling. Maybe I can say some 2.5 hours or 3 hours I was there without moving the body. Then slowly I was able to move the body, and the moment I came down, around 2.5 days or 3 days, like a bliss fever. It was like a fever with intense bliss. It was not a suffering fever, bliss fever. Feeling like I have to go to that place again and again, the place where I had experience. One side it is pulling, the other side, because of this newness or something unknown, the fear was also there. It's like if a young boy falls in love, one side will have a deep pull to meet that person. The other side, because it is an unknown dimension, he himself never experienced, he can feel for somebody so deeply. It's an unknown dimension opening up. That will naturally create a deep fear. How can I open up so much? How can I be open so much? How can I be pulled so much beyond my logic? That fear was also there. I don't know what happened. By and by, within a few weeks, that fear to go and be in that state again and again has disappeared. And after that, never the feeling to come out of the state came. Never the feeling of boredom from that state happened. Never moving out, maybe I can say, it became like an undercurrent of all the activities. And inspired, created more and more energy and intensity to continue the journey. Maybe different meditation techniques, different practices, different tapas, different things. I don't know why all this has happened and all those things. To tell you honestly, there was no, only one thing I can say. After that, there was no suffering. Even during tapas or penance, there was no suffering. It was a pure joy. People ask me, 9 years I lived wandering, begging and eating, sleeping under the trees. 9 years I spent, maybe 10,000 kilometers I would have walked. And 2-3 years I spent in the organizations, like different organizations, Ramakrishna Mission and many other organizations, spiritual organizations. So during my wandering, people ask me, Swamiji, it would have been a great suffering, or how did you live? It's very difficult. Actually, I feel other way, the normal person's life is very difficult. Living in the same house, same car, same city, same wife, same life. Actually, that is more boring. I feel that they are doing real tapas. They are doing real tapas. My life was a joy. It was just an ecstasy. Every day you have something more interesting, exciting, new things in the inner world and in the outer world. It's a great exploration. So after that first experience, there was no suffering. Whatever I did, whatever I lived, from others' view, it may be looking like a suffering or penance or tapas or meditation. From my point of view, it was nothing but a simple exploration, a simple joy, a simple expression. Now, sometimes I sit and read the book. It's not that I am suffering. I am just exploring. Same way, all my tapas, all my meditation, everything was just exploration. It was not suffering. It was not painful at all. Maybe these are the few words I can share. Thank you. Whatever you think as Atma, whatever ideas you have about Atma is just an idea. According to me, if I have to tell an honest answer, just drop those ideas and be very clear that you don't know. Then you will see the truth. Any idea you carry about Atma only becomes a hindrance for realizing the Atma. Ramana Maharshi says very beautifully, I did not even know the word Brahman till I had Brahmanyana. That is why I was able to add easily. So, the concept of Atman is good in the initial level as an inspiration. But after you start your path, better to drop the ideas which you carry about Atma and be very clear that I don't know. See, sometimes the ideas which you carry gives you a pseudo feeling, you know it. And you only need to live it. Then the thirst or the inquiry or the seeking drastically drops. You become a more or less like a manager. Now I know the truth, I need to administer. That is not the case. You don't even know, that is the case. If we know, it will express by itself. I always tell people, the urge should become urgent. The question should become quest. For that, better not to have an idea about Atman. I can give you any idea, long, big talks, big idea, but I will be only disturbing you. I can say, it's in the form of light, consciousness, satta, svabhava, swayam prakasa, jyoti, nirvikalpa, nirananda, niranjana, nisvala, all those big, big words I can give. But all the words are just nothing more than a brand names. Not true. Somebody says Nirvana, somebody says Advaita, somebody says Atmanjnana, somebody says Brahmanjnana. I have my own branding name, Nityananda State. So, something like that. I don't want to repeat all the different brand names. See, that's why I asked you. If you want a social answer, I would have given a long social answer. I don't think that any way going to help you. If you ask the same question in the public, I'll give you a very long answer. Quoting Ramakrishna, quoting Ramana Maharshi, quoting Buddha, quoting Shiva, quoting Shankara, quoting everybody. A long answer because I need to convince him that I know something. Here I don't need to convince you. I can straight away help you. You understand? You are a seeker. I can straight away share with you what really can help you. Usually these big terms are used not to help that person, to help myself. That is the truth. These are all, see, after all I am a young person. So I need to use big words to tell that person. You are sitting in front of a person whom you need to listen. And I think with seekers, I don't have to use the big words. I can straight away tell the truth. This is what I feel. Better not to have an idea once you enter into the journey. Just be very clear, you don't know. That clarity you don't know can lead to such a great depth, can give so much of strength, will bring so much of inspiration. You will never be struggling or in depression. See, depression is the worst problem seekers face in the life. Why they face, you know, they think they know almost everything. They know everything. Only thing, they have to make it as a reality in their life. But that is not the case. If you know the fire will burn, naturally you will not put your hand there. But people tell me, Swamiji, I know everything, fire will burn, but again I am putting my hand there. No, it means you don't know. That is the truth. You have a pseudo knowledge. I can say breaking the pseudo knowledge is what I call Vijnanamaya Kosha Vedana. Breaking the Vijnanamaya Kosha. We live with a very wrong knowledge, very wrong idea. We know everything. That's what I call Vijnanamaya Kosha. Breaking it, having a clarity. This is what I know, this is what I don't know. Let me be very clear. That clarity will break the Vijnanamaya Kosha and can bring so much of strength, clarity, peace into your being. Thank you. Yes.
Have to suffer.
No, the first statement is wrong.
But you said in the family, all we are suffering.
Yes. Sorry?
When we are there in the family, in the same wife, in the same life. So, what is my question that, does it mean that if you are suffering intensely, you are progressing on your path towards God?
Two things. The statement which I made, the same wife, same life, same car, just a jovial statement. But to tell you honestly, neither your wife nor your car or your house is same as yesterday's. It is different. You can't step into the same river twice. I tell you, you can't even step into the same river even once. See, the moment you put your foot, before even it reaches the ground, water moves away. So, your wife is updating herself. Your life is updating itself. The whole existence is constantly updating itself. So my statement, the same wife, same car, same thing, was told in a more casual sense and a jovial sense and how you feel. But that is not the case. Actual truth. That's the first thing. Second thing, if we are suffering, are we growing towards God? No. Something seriously wrong. I can say, in the initial level, you will not have suffering, you will have suffocation. Suffocation is what Ramakrishna calls the seeking or the intense yearning. Vyakulata, that is the word Bhagavan uses, Ramakrishna is using. Vyakulata, the intense yearning. There will be suffocation, not suffering. Suffocation means feeling that you are not enough. You have not expanded what you can. You are not doing what you can. It's just like a missing some part of you. It won't be a suffering. Suffering is different. Suffocation is different. Suffering is something when you think I need this and you are not achieving. That is suffering. Suffocation is you know you are something but you have not become that. Suffocation is from within, suffering from outside. Suffocation is from prarabdha, suffering is from agamya. Prarabdha means the potentiality which you brought with you is prarabdha. Agamya is the desires which you accumulated after coming here. The accumulated desires bring suffering. The agamya brings suffocation. Suffocation inspires and helps you to expand, open up, break. Suffering puts you in deep depression. So I feel suffocation will just explode into joy. There won't be suffering between you and the enlightenment or the Atmanyana. So I can't accept the word if you are suffering more, you are going towards divine, towards God. According to my experience, not only goal, even the path is Anandamaya. Path and goal, both are Anandamaya. In the initial level, the suffocation will be there. Please understand the difference between the suffocation and suffering. Suffering is from the accumulated desires. Suffocation is from your inborn, prarabdha, tendency, the potential energy. So when a seed has not become tree, when the seed is about to break, it has that suffocation, vyakulata. But suffering is after you become tree, suddenly you want maybe 2-3 house built on you or 2-3 cars so that you can get into that. Tree can't move, which you try to accumulate something which is not directly yours, your very quality. That is what I call suffering. Suffering is from akamya, suffocation is from prarabdha. Prarabdha, suffocation may be there in the initial level in your spiritual path, but akamya, the suffering, a depression cannot be there in your spiritual journey. Then there is something wrong if the suffering is there. First sit and clear the suffering. That's a basic need to start your journey. Thank you. Yes. I'll answer 10 more minutes. Okay. Yes.
How do you attain content then?
Sit and contemplate. Make a list of all your desires. All your desires, whatever, even the small to big, even the fulfilled desires, if you remember, it means it is there in you. List and sit and contemplate. Just take up each desire and visualize that it has become reality. How you feel? Add kriya shakti to icha shakti. Add your visualization and creativity to your desires. Suddenly you will see many desires which you thought is your life will drop, will lose its influence over you. Empower your visualization, your desires with your imagination power. Just see that they have become reality and how you feel now. Suddenly you will see many desires which you thought is an important thing in your life will lose its power over you. Those desires are your agamya, accumulated desires. And suddenly you will see some desires will become so strong in you. That's what I call prarabdha, your own desires. With prarabdha, you see prarabdha, great quality of the prarabdha karma is before fulfilling, it will give you a deep inspiration and energy to run behind the desire. After fulfilling, automatically that will give you a deep satisfaction. But with agamya, before fulfilling also you will have a deep irritation. Sometimes you will see, if you remember some desires, you will have a deep irritation. After fulfilling, you will feel the deep emptiness. Agamya will start with irritation and end with emptiness. Prarabdha will start with inspiration, end with fulfillment. So sit and contemplate on all the desires. Take this as a meditation. Every day visualize one desire fully. Create your heaven and live half an hour in that. It may look like imagination. What am I doing? But you will see suddenly there are many desires which you are carrying without even knowing that they have no say over your being. They have no power over your being. When the agamya drops, prarabdha will have its own energy to fulfill itself. Thank you.
Two questions. I am, this is the picture, I am not here to rule, I am God. I am here to where you are God. Please, what is you say you are God?
When I say you are God, I mean whatever you have an idea about God, you are much more than that. Can you describe what you understand by the word God? See, whatever you know about God, the quality or the experience or anything, you are much more than that. That's what I mean. Please understand, if you think God is all-pervading energy, or God, see, if you say Krishna, what do you know about Krishna? The person is such a wonderful joy, power, glory, and all the qualities. He lived his whole life like a leela. See, whenever you start cherishing, enjoying your very existence, the whole life will look like a leela. Krishna lived in that space. That's why we always call Krishna's biography as Krishna Leela. Krishna's history is called Krishna Leela. It was such a wonderful play. Whatever quality you remember, you identify, you associate, you understand in the name of Krishna, you have much more than that. Possibility which is in you, potentiality which is in you, is much more than that. Please understand, I am not disrespecting Krishna. Immediately your mind will say, no, how can I be equal to God? Person who says he is equal to God and person who says he is not equal to God, both are egoistic idiots. Understand? Both are egoistic. At least a person who claims himself as God will have his ego somewhere cornered. Society will not allow that. Somebody will make fun of him. See this fool. He is claiming himself as God. He is a madcap. But the person who is thinking, I am not God, his ego will never be attacked. So he is the worst cunning idiot. He is the most cunning fellow. Topsy-turvy ego. Inferiority ego. He can easily preserve himself, protect himself. Please understand, neither the idea you are nor the idea you are not is ultimate truth. Understand? Actually, I can say this way. The inferiority ego is much more dangerous than superiority belief. Neither you need to say you are not God, nor you need to say you are God. Just experience you are God. That is the truth. Person who is experienced is divine will not feel. People ask me, how do you know you are enlightened? I tell them, the doubt whether I am enlightened or not, or the ego, I am enlightened, both disappears. Both are not there. That is the space. That is the symbol that you are enlightened. Neither you will have a doubt whether I am enlightened or not, nor you will have an ego, I am enlightened. Both will not be there. You will just be radiating, and the people around you will feel that you are living in it. Understand, if you have that idea, you are not God, you are an egoistic idiot. Please, sorry if the word is too strong. I am talking to you as I talk to my ashramites. To my ashramites, I give a very strong words. If you see the original words of Ramakrishna, very strong word. And he uses a lot of Bengali slang. Somehow, unfortunately, in English, everything got edited. and did not get translated. He's such a villager, such a joyful child to read his words. And the similes, examples which he uses, all dirty village comments. And you should read in original Bengali to understand the juicy bean. See, he's portrayed, unfortunately, by the... I think I can tell the truth. These Vedantic Swamis, as a very decent, cultured, which appeals to the modern mind. But he was such a pure, simple, raw being, using straight words, straight cut examples. If you read the original Bengali, now the latest, the original Bengali, the Kathamrita is translated as it is and came out 5 volumes. If you read those things, it's a very straight. Now just why I'm telling you this, please don't mind by the word idiot. You may think that how can an enlightened person use the word idiot? What can be done? That is what I'm using, so nothing can be done. If you want, learn the spirit from that word or judge, waste your time, that's all. I don't have a problem. But why I'm using this kind of strong words, this is the way. I don't feel like editing. The moment I edit these words, the strength or depth with which I want to convince or convey this idea will lose its power over you. That's the reason I am using the exact word. I want to remind you once more, if you think you are not God, you are egoistic. Thank you. Two things. What is happiness and guru? See, the idea, let me be very honest. I always tell people in our ashram, whenever people ask me about this guru and all these things, I tell them, there is a beautiful example. If you allow the calf, it will go and be with the cow only for 10 minutes. But the calf will drink the milk and come out. The bee, fly, which is sitting on the cow 24 hours, it will drink only the blood. So you can have guru, but just drink his blood, give headache to him. And you can be away from guru and drink only milk whenever you go near him. It is not being near a guru's physical presence. I don't think that plays any major role in the seeking. It is the depth of seeking that plays a major role. Ramakrishna very beautifully says, surrender to anything. Surrender is important, not to what you surrender. If you surrender, even a stone can become God and guide you. That's what happened in Ramakrishna's life. It's just a black stone, 3 feet black stone. If you go and see, it looks very funny. This 3 feet black stone showed this Ramakrishna the whole world. The Kali Murti, if you go to Dakshineswar, it's not more than 3 feet. She's just standing with 4 legs and 3 feet black stone. But that stone can show the divine or the cosmic experience to Ramakrishna. So when you surrender, even stone can become God. When that intense seeking is not there, even if God comes in front of you, you'll ask for ID card. You'll ask for ID card. And now you are saying, oh, I'm not having a guru. You think living around me is such an easy joke? Ask them, they will tell you. It's not a joke. You understand? Let the seeking become strong. If the seeking becomes strong, even a small stone can teach you. The life can teach you. Life, you see, the prana which is flowing inside my body, coming out as words, the same prana is flowing everywhere. It can straight away enter your body also and create those same strong teachings inside your heart. Please understand. Because I have become empty bamboo, hollow bamboo, the air which is flowing inside me coming out as a flute music. So the same depth, if it can start happening in you, the air which flows inside your nose can become a strong teaching or inspiration inside your heart. Without that intensity, even if I tell something, even if I utter some word, after 2 days you will not even remember. Oh, that young Swami came. As they brought, okay, he spoke something. I think he spoke well. That's all. People come and tell me usually, you spoke well soon. I just catch the shirt and tell me what I spoke. No. You spoke well. Don't ask that and all. It's just one more word. One more word. A courtesy, are socially polite. Or just to get an attention. You can get attention in two ways. One by throwing stone, another one by praising. Both ways you can get an attention. A polite way of getting attention. Asking for attention. That's also. I don't think the physical nearness is directly relevant than the intense seeking. The intense seeking is what I feel is needed. And maybe I can use one more word. Psychological revolution. A cognitive shift. Seeing, processing the information which you receive, and decision making. This cognition should completely have a shift. As of now, any experience which you add to your being adds more and more fear or greed. Instead of that, any experience add to your being should become strength and awareness, leading you to more awareness. If this cognitive shift happens, if this psychological revolution happens, I think that is what is Guru. That is what I call Guru. So maybe you can work hard for that than being physically around a master. If your prarabdha is to be physically around a master, suddenly you will see you will click with somebody. Somebody will click. You won't even have to think about it. People ask me, am I your master? I tell them, as long as this question is there, forget about me. The moment is, if I am your master, that question will just disappear. And you know, you have seen, and the click happens. So, till the click happens, don't bother. If the click does not happen, also don't bother. Just go towards the psychological revolution. If needed, you will have the click. When it needed, with whomever it needed. If not, you will achieve the truth as it is. There is no need to bother. And this question, happiness. I can give an honest answer. I can give an honest answer. Or you need, again, socially polite. No. You need an actual honest answer. There is no such thing as happiness. That's an honest answer. Maybe when there is a gap between suffering, you call that as happiness. If you are beaten less number of times by the society and the surroundings, you call that as happiness. It is just a comparative drama. There is only two things in the planet Earth. One is suffering, another one is bliss. Understand? Bliss. Bliss as a positive existence, like a light. Suffering as a negative existence, as a darkness. Darkness has no positive existence, understand? Lightlessness is darkness. So blisslessness is suffering. So bliss as positive existence, suffering as negative existence means it does not exist. When there is no bliss, suffering. The joy or happiness is a comparative reality. For something can be happy, for something can lead you to happiness, but the same thing can lead the other person into suffering. So happiness is just a comparative reality, the comparative drama. It's only a comparative reality, it's not an existential reality. Please understand, happiness is not existential reality. So according to my experience, there is no such thing as happiness. Either you have suffering or you have bliss. When you have less suffering, you just give little courage to yourself. You need to justify your existence, you see. You need to justify yourself that still why you are not committing suicide. So that is the reason you just tell yourself or console yourself, I have happiness. That is, see all the moments of happiness. Just enquire them. I have seen these guys, these people, they will go for some vacation, picnic. They will take big pictures. They will not enjoy at that moment the thing, nature in front of them. They will take pictures and come back to the home after 2 years. See, in those days when we went for honeymoon, in the picnic, see how happy we were. These guys forget that they only shouted cheese and they posed with smile for the photograph. See, when the photograph itself was taken, these guys shouted cheese and they all smiley and the photograph was taken. After 2 years, they forget it was posed to smile. When they were in that space, exactly in that spot, what they think the joy was not there. See, after 2 years, when they look back, what fantasy they have. Oh, 2 years ago when we went there, it was such a great joy. But when they were there, actually, that experience itself was not there. So the photograph was posed. Just look your life. Anything you claim as happiness, you think as happiness, is only the fantasy or the memory, which is little better than the present. When you can't tolerate the present, you just attribute little joy to the past and hope that same past can be repeated in the future and pull your life, drag your life. That's all is the definition for happiness. If I have to say in one sentence, it is just nothing but trying to reproduce the hope about the past into the future. Into the future. Please understand, neither the hope which you have about the experience of the past, nor the hope you can reproduce in the future is going to be reality. Drop that and drop this. Drop your idea of happiness in the past and drop the hope to reproduce that same thing in the future. Suddenly you will find bliss in your being. Your idea, you had happiness in the past. Your idea, you can have that same happiness in the future. Both, which is not there, but which gives you the idea as if it is there, is what I call Maya. It was not there, but you have an idea, it was there. It is never going to be reproduced, but you have a hope it can be reproduced. This is what I call Maya. If you can relax from both, suddenly you will see the reality itself is such an ecstasy. The prana going inside your body and making you alive and coming out of your body is existence. That is a great joy, a leela. You are the part of cosmic leela. You are the part of cosmic play. Suddenly you will see, when you remember you are part of the cosmic play, you feel that you are blessed. You are needed. You are here out of a reason or necessity. You are not an accident. You will feel your life is needed and it is a fulfillment and it is a great ecstasy. So, let you all just understand and remember these few things. Maybe I can say a few words, essence of whatever I expressed. See, live with an intense excitement and joy, whatever may be happening around you. That intense joy and excitement will make your body deliver its maximum, will make your mind deliver its maximum, will make the whole cosmos to deliver its maximum to you. So, live with that intense joy and excitement so that your body can deliver, your mind can deliver, and the whole cosmos can deliver the optimum, ultimate to your very being. Let you all achieve and radiate the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.